Hello everyone, how are you?
Hello sir, you're good.
Hello. So today we would start new topic. It's called reducibility. Okay, I think it's fixed perimeter, so we can start our lecture. So in this chapter, we will learn an important technique. This technique is used. So if you remember that I told you that there are basically two things that we need to talk about in this course. First is about the computation. And the second is complexity. So we are almost at the end of computation and we would soon start complexity. But there is a topic that connects complexity and computation, and this reducibility is the thing that we would use most in complexity, but we would also use this topic in some of the or special aspects of computation. So let's see what is reducibility. So we say that a reduction is a way. It's a way of converting one problem to another. Let me write the definition and then I will explain what does it mean. So this is the definition of an important concept in mathematics and computer science, which we call reduction. So such reducibilities actually come up very often in everyday life, but we usually don't refer to them in this particular way. So what is reduction? So reduction is that, suppose that you want to find your way around a new city. You are in a new city and you want to know your way around. So you also know that doing so would be easy if you had a map. So for example, if you have never been to Lahore and you go to Lahore and you want to find your way in that city, but you are not familiar with the city. So and we all know that if you had a map of the city, then it would be easier for you to find places and addresses and move around. So we know the problem is that you want to go to some particular address in Lahore. Okay, you are in Lahore, you want to go to that particular address. And you are new to that city and you do not know your way around. But you also know that if you had access to map, for example, or the map app on your phone, then you can find your way, then you can find your And you can go there. So actual problem is to go to this address, but then you reduce this problem in finding a map. Once you have a map, you can use the map to find you, right? So there are two problems. So the problem number one, go to this address. Problem number two, get a map. And you can solve your problem number one, which is to go to a certain location, by reducing that problem into a problem which you already know a solution to. For example, you know how to get a map, so you get the map, you know how to use the map, you use the map, and you go through your location. Okay, so you reduce your problem of finding your way around in the city to the problem of obtaining a map of a city. Right? So these are two distinct problems. Obtaining a map of a city is an independent problem that can be a problem in itself. For example, you just want the map for any reason, and finding your way in a city is a different problem, which is an independent problem. But you reduce your problem number one, which is to find a way in your city, into a problem that is just to obtain the map. And once you obtain the map, you know that you can use the knowledge that you will gain from the map to solve the problem that is to find your way around or to go to a certain location. In that. So this is called reduction. So this is just an example of reduction. So a reduction is basically a way of converting one problem to another problem in such a way that you can use the solution of the second problem to solve the first problem. Okay? So is this in clear? So whenever we have reduction, we have two problems. So reductions involve two problems. Okay, let's call them A and B. Okay, we say that if A reduces to B, it means we can use a solution to B to solve. So it is important. This part is very important. Okay. So in our example, so the example that I just gave, in our example, the problem A is to find your way around in Lahore. And problem B is to obtain the map of Lahore. Right? Is this thing clear? So whenever you have two problems, problem A and we have another problem B, we want to solve. So we want to solve problem A, okay? We know a solution to B. What we do, we reduce problem A to B. Okay? And use a solution for B We use the solution for B to solve problem. So whenever we have reduction, we have two problems. And we solve the problem A using a solution from problem B. Okay. So what is important here? What is important here? So whenever we have reduction, okay, reduction does not say anything about solving A. But only about Okay. So this is very important to know. So whenever we use reduction or when we talk about reduction, And we know that in reduction, we need two problems. Whenever we have reduction, and the problem is A and B, it does not say anything about solving either of these two problems, right? So reduction does not tell you that how to solve A or how to solve B. Solving these problems alone, right? So you cannot solve any problem alone using reduction. So what it tells you that you can, it talks about the solvability of A. That is, there is a possibility of finding an answer by finding a solution to problem A in the presence of the solution to the problem B. So this is all about reduction. So we will talk about reduction in detail. And we will see some examples, more complete examples. But before we do that, any questions? Yes, any questions?
And I wanted to ask something.
Yes, please, go ahead.
Sir, if we discuss that it in a reducibility, we will first find the solution to the problem of B, right? To solve A.
No.
Isn't that case?
No.
Like in our example, we first find the map and with the help of that, we solve the A.
Okay. So we have a problem A, right? And we have a problem B. We want to solve A. We do not know how to solve A. But suppose there exists a solution to B. Okay. Suppose there exists a solution. If we know that we can reduce our problem A into B, then we can use the solution to B to solve it. It does not say that please solve B first. No, it doesn't say. It says that suppose there exists a solution. It may not exist, okay, or we may not know the solution, but if a solution exists to B and we know there's a way to reduce A into B, then that's it.
So we will reduce a problem to that problem which already has a solution.
Again, it doesn't mean that it already has a solution. It means that there may exist a solution. That solution may be completely theoretical, okay, or completely hypothetical. That's okay.
Okay. Okay.
So it means that if a solution for B exists, solution for A exists. It does not tell us that how to solve B, or it does not tell us how to solve A, but it says that if a solution to B exists, we do not know what solution is, but if a solution to B exists, then we know that how to solve A using the solution. Okay, so it is important. It is important.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, now remember, yes.
Sir, so over here, we are not worried about what the solution is. We're just checking if we can reduce A to B, then whatever the solution of B is, we can use the solution to reach to a solution for A, right?
Yes, something like that. Okay, I can give you a very simple example. Actually, it's a very simple example. This is called bogus salt. I think you might have heard the name bogus salt. So what does this bogus salt, do? It says that there's input. Okay, and input is an array of n elements, okay, n numbers. Those numbers are a1, a2, an, or you can say a1, a2. So it doesn't matter how you define these numbers, okay? The output is, let's say you want some permutation, ai1 is less than or equal to ai2 is less than or equal to some permutation. That is, you want to sort this array. So what you can do, you can have a step number one, which is while you check a function you call a function is sorted. Okay. Let's say not. If it is not sorted, then what you could do, you would say A, let's say A, let's say 0 is A prime is A. A prime is a random permutation of step number 3. That's it. Step number 3. Print or output. Okay. So this is a very simple algorithm. What it does is it checks the input array. If it is sorted, okay, then it just comes out of the loop and prints. If it is not sorted, then it generates a random permutation of A, random permutation, any permutation, and checks if that random permutation is sorted. Right? And then checks again and again and again. So this is one of the slowest sorting algorithms. Right? This is one of the slowest sorting algorithms. Now the question is, there is a routine over here, is sorted A, right? So this routine, which checks given an array here is sorted or not, so it returns, yes, that is a true value. It returns a Boolean value. Returns true or false. If it returns true, it means that the input is sorted. If it returns false, it means that the input is not sorted. Now, how this routine works is none of the concern of this program bogus. Bogus sort depends on the solution of is sorted, right? So if a solution to is sorted exists, a solution to sort this array also exists. This is not a very good example in a sense that we know that this algorithm will take much, much more time than actually sorting the array because we know that it may never come up with an answer. But this is just an example of showing that how we reduce problems from one instance to another, right? So if a solution to is sorted exists, we know a solution to bogus sort it also exists, right? So reduction is something like that. So we have a problem A and we have a problem B. We reduce the problem A into problem B. And we assume that if there exists a solution to B, then we can use the solution of B to solve A. Now, how this problem B is solved, it's none of our concern. What the concern is that there exists a solution of B. Okay. So is this in clear? Okay. Now remember, we covered in detail, in very much detail, we covered ATM, okay? And we found that ATM is undefined. So we already have proven that ATM is undefined, right? So let us come up with another language, and we would call this language H. I will give this language H a different name. And I say the language is H. And this language is defined as this way. It is M and W, such that M is a TM. And M calls on W. Okay. So this is the machine M. It takes the input W, and this machine will either accept or it will reject. But since M is a TM, there's a third possibility, and that is stuck in an infinite loop. Right, so it is possible that this machine may get stuck in an infinite loop. However, this language HTM says that it will contain all those encodings for Turing machines, along with the strings W, such that those Turing machines M called on W. Okay, all possible Turing machines that they may exist and all possible inputs that those Turing machines can process, they will be part of this language if those inputs W halt on the machine M. So for those inputs W, machine M halts, or the machine M halts for those input W, right? So this is the language. So we need to figure out if HTM is decidable or not. Can anyone tell me if HTM is decidable? Yes. Can anyone tell me if HTM is decidable? So the answer is no. HTM is not decidable. Okay. And why? So here is the proof. Proof is very simple. Proof is by contradiction. Proof is by contradiction. So we say that assume HTM is decided. Number one. Step number two. Okay. That assume HTM is decidable. So if it is decidable, it means that there exists some Turing machine R that decides it. Okay. There exists some Turing machine R which decides HTM. Okay. Now we construct a new Turing machine S as follows. Okay. And there's a special thing that this S does. Okay? And I will explain that what does S do. So you say that S is a Turing machine which on the input so we know that on this input M is the encoding of the machine, W is a string that this machine accepts or accepts as the input. So what we would do, we would run Turing machine R on the input W. Okay. Step number two. If R rejects, okay, then reject. This reject is for machine S. If R accepts, okay, then simulate M on W until it halts. Okay. If M has accepted, then accept. If M has rejected, then reject. Okay. And that's the description of the machine S. We come out of this machine, we say that if R decides HTM, then S design. Since ATM is undecidable, HTM is also undecidable. Is this thing clear? So we are trying to prove if this language STM is decidable or not. Okay, if this language STM is decidable or not. Okay, so what we do, we say that we prove it by contradiction, and this proof is basically this proof actually uses a reduction, and I will explain that where is the reduction. So first, since it is by a contradiction, so assume that this machine HTM is decided. If it is decidable, then there must exist Turing machine R that decides this HTM, right? So if this is the case, then we can construct a new Turing machine S, and this is how this Turing machine S will work. How this will work? So we would say that we will pass the input MW to this Turing machine S. This is the new Turing machine. Inside this Turing machine S, it will run R on the input MW. Okay. And what is this R? R is a machine that decides HTM. Remember, we just assume that R exists because we assume that HTM is decidable and R decides it. So we send this MW to R. And we will prove that we show that this machine S is a solution, is a TM, is a Turing machine, which basically decides ATM. Okay, which basically decides ATM. Okay, therefore, and since we know that ATM is undecidable, therefore HTM must also be undecidable, because if there exists a machine S which decides ATM, then we would be able to decide HTM. And since we know that there doesn't exist any machine which decides ATM, therefore our assumption that HTM is decidable is also wrong and it is undecided. So can you tell me where is the reduction? Which problem is reduced to which problem?
So we reduce our problem of HTM, which is HTM is decidable or not, to the problem that S is decidable or not. Sorry, ATM is decidable or not.
Okay, anyone else? So we have two things, right? We have HTM, and we have ATM. By the way, this HTM is basically a machine called HALT. So halting. On one hand, we have HTM, HALT, Turing machine, and we have ATM. So my question is the reduction in this way or it is in this way? Which problem reduces to which problem? Does HALT reduce to A or A reduces to HALT? Is it in this direction, that is the forward? I mean, forward or backward is not, means relative. Is it in this direction or in this direction? In this particular situation? Yes, can anyone try? Yes. Anyone? So we have one answer. Somebody answer. Forward direction. Yeah. Anyone else who says the forward direction?
That is this direction that
HTM reduces speed. Anyone? Who thinks that this is this way, ATM Is there anyone who thinks this?
Yes.
I think by now you should have some understanding that whenever we have such questions, then the most obvious answer is definitely wrong. Okay. So what do you think? What is the right answer? What do you think is the right answer?
Answer one or answer two? Yes, please.
I'm waiting. All right, there's a 50-50 chance because there are two possible answers. So you can be 50% right, 50% wrong. The right answer is two.
One is wrong answer. Okay.
The forward direction is the wrong answer. Backward direction is the right answer. Well, forward, backward is not correct here because placing of these problems on this paper was arbitrary. Right? So the right reduction is that ATM reduces to HD. And why it is this reduction? It is this reduction because you remember I said that we have two problems A and we have a problem B. We want to show that we can solve A if there exists a solution to B, right? So we say that ATM reduces to HTM. ATM reduces to HTM. If in fact, we have a solution to ATM, not a solution to HTM. But still, we say that ATM reduces to HTM. And we assume that if there exists a solution to HTM, then we would be able to solve ATM. And in that case, if a solution exists to HTM, then ATM would be decidable,
which goes against
what we already have proven. Therefore, it is impossible that HTM is decidable.
Right?
It is impossible. It is impossible that there exists a solution. So we prove by reduction that it is impossible to solve B. So we assume that, imagine there exists a solution to B. If a solution to B exists, then we would be able to solve something which we already have proven that it is impossible to solve. So it means that B cannot be solved. Why? Because ATM reduces to STM. Is this unclear? It may be confusing, but I would like you to pay attention. Yes. I'm not hearing anything. Is anyone talking? Are you all here?
Yes, sir, we are here.
Okay. So I would like students to participate. So if it doesn't matter if you're wrong. Okay? That's okay. That's all right. This is how you learn. So you need to give answers even if you think you are wrong. Perfectly all right. Is this thing clear? I know it's confusing and it's a little bit complicated, but let me know if there is any confusion, still any confusion. If there is some confusion, we can go back and redo everything.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, when we were discussing about the proof of this example, The last statement you written, it says that if HTM is decidable, then S decides ATM. So, sir, isn't this the dependency upon the ATM about H?
I don't get like that question.
Isn't it like that ki agar ATM decidable hai to HTM decidable hoga?
Yes, exactly.
Sir, in this way to hum HTM ko ATM mein reduce nahi kar rahe?
Nahin. That's the
thing here. So it is important that when you do reduction,
you don't assume that we can solve A with B or B with A or there exists a solution for it. No.
So what we do, so we say that there are two problems. We reduce one problem to the other and we assume that, so let's say the problem, first problem is A and the second problem is B. We say that we reduce A to B or A reduces to B. It means that if there exists a solution to B, then we can solve A. We can use the solution of B to solve A. Okay, so now we have two things. We know there are two things, and those things are, so we already have spent a lot of time on proving that ATM is undecidable, right? So we all know that it is undecidable, and we came to this proof without any reduction. We actually prove that ATM is undecidable, right? Now this is a well-known fact, we know about. Now we come across a new problem, which we call HTM. Okay, this is a new problem. We do not know if a solution to this problem exists or not. Okay, we know that we do not know if the solution to this problem exists or not. But by inspecting ATM and HTM, we find that there are some similarities between these two. And those similarities enable us to make a reduction from ATM to HTM. That is, if we assume, so there are two possible answers to HTM. It is either undecidable, okay, or it is decidable, right? There is no third answer here. HTM is either decidable or it is undecidable. We do not know. Imagine that we started working on this problem and this problem just popped out of somewhere. And we just wanted to find out if it is decidable or undecidable, right? And we do not know a solution. There are only two possible answers. Either it is decidable or it is not decidable. Okay. So what we say, okay, we go with the first one, which we say that imagine this is decidable. Imagine this is decidable. If this is decidable, then because it is decidable, it will entail some things. That is, it will enable us to create the machine S that we used in the proof of the theorem. And that machine S is a machine that actually decides a problem, which we referred as ATM.
Okay.
So our assumption that HTM is decidable leads to an absurd conclusion. And whenever such an assumption, whenever any assumption leads to an absurd conclusion, it means that our assumption is wrong. And since there are only two possible things that we could assume, either it is undecidable or decidable, and one of them is wrong, the other must be right. Other must be right. It is impossible that it is right. Now the question may arise, that where is the reduction or why do we need reduction? So the thing is that we actually do not need reduction over here. But there was an implicit reduction underlying. Okay, that is, we were trying to solve HTM using ATM. Sorry, we were trying to solve ATM using HTM. Okay, so there is an underlying implicit reduction. And that reduction just came up because of the way we constructed and because of the way we assume that H is decidable, right? And that is, there is this reduction. So let us do a couple more examples and it will become clear that what we intend by this reduction in detail. And specifically when we will deal about reductions in complexity theory context, it will become extremely clear. So there is actually a joke, there are so many jokes on reduction. So let me share one specific joke that I vividly remember from my undergrad time. So just give me a second. Okay, so the joke goes this way. A physicist and a mathematician, so there are two people, a physicist and a mathematician, they are sitting in a faculty lounge. Suddenly, the coffee machine catches on fire. Okay, the physicist grabs a bucket and leaps forward the sink, fills the bucket with water, and puts out the fire. Okay, so these two mathematicians are sitting in a faculty lounge. One is a mathematician, one is a physicist, and there is a machine, and there's a fire in the coffee machine. So physicist quickly grabs a bucket and puts water from the sink. So there's a sink nearby. So he turns on the tap, fills the bucket with water, and puts out the fire. Okay. So second day, the same two people are sitting in the lounge. And again, there's a fire in the coffee machine, in the same coffee machine. But this time what happens is the mathematician stands up. Okay. Got a bucket. Okay. And hands the bucket to the physicist and says that I have reduced the problem, okay, for which a solution already exists. So now it's physicist's job to go get the bucket filled with water and put out the fire. So mathematician's job is done over there. Right? So this joke comes in many different variations and varieties. This is one particular variety. There are other varieties as well. For example, a physicist is sent to a room where there's a sink, there's a bucket, and there's a tap on the sink. And physicist is asked to fill the bucket with water. The physicist goes inside the room, takes the bucket, fills the bucket with water, and puts it on the floor. Okay, and he's done. Then mathematician is sent to the same room, okay, and he's asked to do the same job, that is to fill the bucket with water. But when the mathematician enters, the bucket is already filled with the water because physicist filled it. So what he does is he empties the bucket in the sink, puts the bucket on the floor, comes out of the room and says that I've reduced the problem to the one that has already been solved by the physicist. So there are so many other jokes with reduction. So reduction is not a way that, we use reduction almost every day in many different ways, right? So sometimes we know that a solution is possible. And we maybe the problem that we are working with is the brand new problem. We might not have seen that problem ever in our lives. But we somehow connect that problem with something that already has a solution, right? And we know that since we could solve that problem, this problem cannot also be solved. So this is about reduction. So let's go ahead and do a few more things, and then we will see that how this reduction will, how it works actually. So let us come up with a new language, which we call ETM. Okay, ETM is a language that consists of all the encodings of Turing machine's M, such that M is a TM, okay? And language of M is empty, okay? Language of M is empty. So we have a result. It says that ETM is undecidable. Can you prove it using reduction? Okay, again, the reduction would be from ATM. Actually, we have a notation for this. We say that let's not use that. We will use that notation. So the reduction is that we assume it is by contradiction. The proof is by contradiction. So we would assume ETM is decidable. If it is decidable, there must exist a machine R which decides ETM. Okay. Now, if R is a machine that decides ETM, then we would be able to construct a Turing machine S, because R is decidable, so we will be able to come up with a Turing machine S. I will explain that what is this S. And if it is possible to do this, then we would see that this machine S will actually decide ETM. This is a contradiction. Therefore, ETM is also undecided. Okay, so we will go through the details, but this is the outline.
Okay, should we go with the proof?
Is S is another Turing machine which will decide an ATM?
Yes, we will construct.
Okay.
It's very similar to the proof that we did for HTM. It's very similar. Okay. Okay, so the proof is very simple. It's again proof by contradiction. So we assume that ETM is decidable. So if it is decidable, then we would show that ATM is also decidable, which is a contradiction, and that is basically a reduction as well. And this contradiction will tell us that ETM is not decidable. Okay. So imagine that R is the machine that decides ETM. We would use R to construct a new machine S, which will decide ATM. And because S will decide ATM, that will complete the proof that since it is, because it is impossible, so that define. Okay, but remember, if you remember the proof of the last one, so we say that the machine S will work on the input MW. Right? Over here we have M, but we do not have any W. Okay. So how to work with this W. This is important. Okay, so one idea is that we would run S. So S will run R on input M. Why input M? Because R is a machine that decides ETM. And ETM only has one possible input, not two inputs. So we would run S. So inside S, we would run R on the input M. And we would check if R accepts M or not. If it does accept, then we know that L of M is empty, and therefore M does not accept any string W. Do you get this idea? So what is this R? R is defined as, R is a machine that decides ETM. What is this ETM? ETM is a language that consists of encodings of M such that M is a TM. And language of M is MTM.
Okay.
So we construct a machine S. Now this machine S will work on, so we would say that on input M and R, we know that M is a machine, but since R only accepts one input, right? See, there is only one input. There are not two inputs. So what you would do, we would run R on this input.
Okay.
So running R on this input means that R will give us two answers, accept or reject. When R accepts its input, it means that the language of M is empty.
Okay.
Language of M is empty. And when R rejects, it means that the language of M is not empty. So when the language of M is empty, then it means, so when R accepts M, it means
M
does not accept any string. Not just the string W, it does not accept any string.
And
on the other hand, if it rejects, it means that the language is not empty and there must exist one string at least, which this machine accepts. Okay. Is this in clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think that's it. We should not go in more detail. That's enough for the part. Okay, we have one more result, and that result we would do without any proof. And that result is, consider this language, which we call
regular.
So this regular is a language which says that M is an encoding of a Turing machine such that the language accepted by the Turing machine is regular.
Okay, do you understand what is this language? What is this problem?
So we know that Turing machines are powerful machines, right? Okay. Turing machines can accept regular language. Right? Turing machines can accept context-free languages. And Turing machines can accept any language that we can think of, right? Any computable property. So if Turing machines can accept those decidable languages, then they can definitely accept or decide regular languages. So the question is, so we define a new problem. So let's call it regular TM. It says that it will contain description of all those Turing machines such that the language accepted by each of this Turing machine is regular. Okay, we do not know how many such machines are. There must be infinitely many. So we will take one Turing machine and see that what is the language that is accepted by this machine. If the language of that machine is regular, we will put the description into this set. We will take another Turing machine and check if the language of that machine is also regular. We will put that. And if the language of any machine is not regular, we will not put we will not put the description of that machine in this set. So this set will definitely contain infinitely many Turing machines. Okay, infinitely many Turing machines. So the question that we ask, given any description, of a Turing machine, okay? Let's call it M. Given any description of a Turing machine, can we decide if M belongs to regular? This is exactly what we are trying, right? So we are again trying to answer the membership quiz. So if M belongs to regular, then accept. If M does not belong to regular, then reject. It's a very simple task. But we conclude that we have a theorem which says that regular theorem is undecided. Okay. The proof is again very simple. We will not go into the proof. We would use the same kind of proof that if it is possible, then it will lead to contradictions, absurd ideas, and therefore it is impossible. So I think we should stop at this point and take a break, a short break in 15 minutes, and come back with some new ideas. Okay. So I'll see you at 7:45. Okay. So we find that regular TM is also undecided. Okay, so the proof idea is very similar to the proof for the other theorems. That is, if regular TM is decidable, then it will conclude that ATM is also decidable, which is not correct. Therefore, our assumption that regular is undecidable, regular is decidable is wrong, and regular is undecidable. Anyway, we have one last theorem that we need to talk about. And the language that we talk about is EQ. Yeah. So EQ means that we are talking about the equality. So this is a language that has a pair of descriptions of or encodings of the machines. So M1 and M2 are Turing machines, such that language of M1 is same as language of M2. Okay, and the theorem says EQTM is undecided. Can you prove it? Again, the proof idea is very similar, that if we think that EQTM is decidable, then it will lead to an absurd conclusion. Therefore, EQTM must be undecidable. But how we can think about it? I think this theorem has the easiest proof so far. So the proof, a proof goes this, like.
So
imagine or assume R is a TM. That decides PQ. Okay. We can construct a Turing machine as follows. S is a Turing machine. Okay. On input. Input M, where M is the description of Turing machine. What we need to do, we need to run on M and M1. Okay, M is exactly this one. And what is M1? Where M1 is a Turing machine. That rejects all inputs. Or in other words, the language of M1 is empty. In other words, L of M1 is empty. Now we assume that R is a Turing machine that decides EQTM. So what, whenever we send two descriptions of Turing machines, it will tell us that if these two languages are same or not. If they are same, it will accept. If they are different, they would it would reject. So if R is a decider, then it will also tell us that if M is empty or not. If it can successfully tell if M is empty or not, then it means that it can check, it can actually check what are the languages of these two machines. So we would say if R accepts, then accept, okay, reject otherwise. Okay, so in other words, if R, this R decides EQTM, then we should be able to check if the language of both M and M1 is same or not. If it is same, it means that R was doing its work perfectly and it can do its work for any two pairs of description of Turing machines. And therefore, we are able to come up with a machine R which does it. And if we are able to come up with such a machine R, then it means that we can actually create this machine S. And then there's a problem, and we already know that this machine S. So this time we did not reduce ATM to EQTM. No, we did not do this thing. Rather, we did ETM to EQTM. So this machine S basically solves the problem EQTM. It solves a problem. So if such a machine R exists, we would be able to solve this problem. But we already know that ETM is undecidable. Therefore, EQTM is undecidable. That's the end of the proof. Is this clear?
How many students are in there? Oh, there are just three students.
Good. Okay. Is this thing clear? Any question?
Sir, where did the M2 go?
There is no M2.
No, in the start. there was EQTM consists M1 and M2.
Does it solve your question concern now?
Sir, I was asking in the proof that in the proof you didn't.
I agree. But actually, I have answered here. M1 and M2 are dummy names. They are variable names, right? So we can replace these variable names anyway. So let me write the proof again. And I will this time use different variables. So everything else will remain same. We assume that EQTM is decidable. And R decides. Okay. So we construct a new machine S, and this new machine S is this way. On input M, okay, where M is the description of Turing machine. Step number one, run R on M and M2. Okay. Where M2, so M2 is a Turing machine. That's it. Now, can you ask the question again? I've changed the variable names. So rather than calling it M1, M2, I call it AB. Rather than calling it M1, I'm calling it M2. Yes. Does it answer your question?
So, sir, it means that A and B are being used as M and M2 on R?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Now I got it.
You get it? Right. So these names are just variable names, dummy variables.
Okay.
So these are parameters. Thank you. Right? So they do not have any meaning other than the context. Is this in clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think there are only three students left. Not three, just two. Three students. Yeah. Three students left. And there is nothing more that I need to cover from this chapter. I need to start a new chapter on complexity, which we will do after each. So our next class would be on next.
Okay. The Turing machine is finished.
Next Saturday is, I think, 24th. No, we did not finish Turing machines because complexity will also use Turing machines. We will not study Turing machines, but we will use Turing machines. Okay. I thought that I could start complexity today, but now it seems impossible. We would have still 2 weeks to finish everything. That's not less than 2 weeks, actually, 4 classes to finish everything. Anyway, we'll try to finish this. Next quiz, I will announce. Okay, thank you very much.
I'll stop sharing my screen. If you have any other questions, please let me know. Otherwise,
Thank you for this.
Any questions? Okay, in that case, thank you very much. I'll see you on.
Sir, I have one question.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I wanted to ask that in our portal, it says that we have a final exam on 3rd August. But yes, according to our course plan, you tell us that we will be having exam 2 before the actual date of a final exam. So will that be the final exam, or that exam 2 will be the final exam?
Yeah, the issue is that when I created that outline, I did not know exactly what will happen with the final exam. It was not announced. Then later on, it was announced by ABA, and the policy is that it has to be during the same times. So we will have the exam according to IDA policy.
Okay, sir. So it means that we will be having final exam on 3rd August.
Yeah, whatever. It could be 3, 2. I'm not sure exactly what IBA will tell us. But whatever time it will tell us, we will conduct the exam.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Allah Hafiz, sir.
Allah Hafiz. Bye-bye.